Good afternoon. I'm Brent Roussin, Manitoba's Chief Provincial Public Health Officer. Today we're announcing two new cases of COVID-19. Two probable cases have been tested as negative, therefore our total number of cases remains at 246. We are reporting one additional death due to COVID-19. This was a woman in her 60s who lived in the Prairie Mountain Health Region. I want to extend my condolences to her family and loved ones. This brings the total number of COVID-related deaths in Manitoba to 5. As of this morning, 9 individuals are hospitalized. Of that, 4 are in intensive care. 108 individuals are listed as recovered. There are 132 active cases. Yesterday, 305 tests were completed at CADM Provincial Lab. This brings the total tests completed to 17,902. We caution Manitobans to not interpret these case numbers to mean our risk is reduced at this time. These numbers likely reflect Manitobans' efforts at our strict social distancing strategies, as well as public health's efforts at case identification, contact identification, and isolation. This is reaffirming that these measures have been effective, but need to be continued. This is why the public health orders have been extended up until April 28th. This is helping us to flatten our curve, to reduce the impact of this virus, to interrupt the transmission of this virus in our communities. Non-essential personal travel should be canceled or postponed. Those returning to Manitoba from international travel or even from interprovincial travel are required to self-isolate for 14 days. This virus is in every health region, and we've seen evidence of community spread. All Manitobans need to take these precautions, to stay home for the most part, to practice physical distancing, to only leave for necessary reasons, and when you are out, to keep that 2 meter separation between others, to frequently wash your hands. If you are mildly ill, stay home. Do not attend work or activities if you have symptoms of illness. You know, there's times when people do need to go out, and certainly people living with disabilities can certainly be affected by these times. I want to remind Manitobans that there's times when people living with disabilities may need assistance. And so you may see that physical distancing may not always be attainable in those circumstances. This is certainly acceptable. There are a lot of precautions people can put in place to frequently hand wash. I want you to be mindful of people who live with disabilities. It includes those who are visually impaired. Some may require assistance at times. Other people with other disabilities may require assistance. So we should be mindful of that and not be too judgmental in our frame of mind right now with physical distancing. Obviously, we need to ensure all Manitobans are safe during these times. You know, we again hear a number of stories of late presentations for medical illnesses other than COVID-19. I really want to make it clear to Manitobans that our hospitals, our healthcare system is safe to utilize. Certainly the message is if you are mildly ill, stay home, call health links. But if you think you may be in need of medical care, it's certainly safe to attend for care. Our hospitals are safe. Our health professionals take every precaution. Our health system has been building its capacity, so certainly do not avoid necessary medical care. Stay in touch with your healthcare providers. Stay on top of your chronic health conditions, and if you have acute conditions, please do not delay getting attention to those. Our healthcare facilities are safe, and they're there to help you in these circumstances. So call health links if you need further information. If it's an emergency, certainly call 911. But do not let other health issues get out of hand during these times. We have a lot of advice out there, Manitobans. Manitobans are really stepping up to interrupt the transmission here, but there are other health issues, so please do not forget about those. I want to remind you to continue to seek credible information. Our website, manitoba.ca/COVID-19, is up to date. And try to search up credible information, withstand the reach for fear or stigma in these times. It's the knowledge that will get us through it. It's our actions that are getting us through this right now. So I want to continue to encourage Manitobans to stay up to date on the information and to continue our efforts, which appear to be paying off at this point. All that is to show us that we are not helpless against this virus, that our actions are showing some effects, and that now is the time to continue with those actions. We cannot loosen up our social distancing strategies. We need to continue with them right now. We need to address these next couple critical weeks in this outbreak. Then we can start to look at the possibilities of loosening some of these measures. We know that we're going to deal with this virus going forward for quite some time, but not necessarily to the degree that what we're looking at right now. So I think we should be optimistic, but we should not loosen our grip right now on these measures. We need to ensure physical distancing, stay home as much as possible. The orders are in place and will remain in place until at least April 28th. And I want to thank Manitobans for all their efforts, which are starting to show off in our numbers at this time. So thank you, and I'll pass that over to Lanette now.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I want to begin today by providing an update on the health of our clinical providers. To date, occupational and environmental safety and health reports that 21 healthcare workers have tested positive for COVID-19. These staff members primarily work in health facilities in Winnipeg, 19 in total, plus there are two positive cases involving healthcare workers that have been confirmed in Interlake Eastern Regional Health Authority. We remain at zero in Prairie Mountain Health, Northern Regional Health Authority, and Southern Health Saint-Isoud. Of the 21 cases, we can share that 7 were nurses, are nurses, 3 medical staff, and 10 from various allied health and support areas. And within the recovered category, we can update that 9 have returned to work and 12 continue to self-isolate. We can further update that we have not had a positive healthcare worker confirmed as COVID-19 positive since April 9th. We do consider this to be in large part related to the extensive contact tracing that was involved with each positive case to identify close contacts and potential exposures, and also part of the extensive screening methods that are happening. So I just want to thank all the staff who have been really conscientious, and that's a stressful time for everyone, and hopefully we're on the other side, and so thanks everyone for working through that. Winnipeg is also opening its second COVID-19 assessment clinic at Sergeant Tommy Prince Place today. The assessment clinic offers primary care services on an appointment basis for anyone who has tested positive for the virus or else has any respiratory symptoms such as cough, sore throat, any shortness of breath. So people should call their family physician or their primary care provider to determine if they need an appointment. At this space, the Sergeant Tommy Prince Place, there's also a testing site, so you can get swabbed there. And it's in a separate spot from the assessment clinic, but in the same area. So with this now open and underway, Mount Carmel Clinic will return to its mandate of offering primary care services to the community. The hours for both the clinic and the testing site are from 9 till 5, 7 days a week. And I also just wanted to provide an update on the isolation centers. So these isolation centers, as you recall, were established for those individuals, both staff and patients, who tested positive and required a dedicated space to isolate, as well as close contacts of COVID-positive patients. So we've been using a number of different ways to ramp up the use and availability of these centers. And it's a multi-pronged approach. So we've been working with multiple provincial government departments. We've been working with the federal government, which has a mandate to ensure that returning international travels are isolated upon their return to Canada. We've been working with hotels. We've been working with homeless shelters, First Nations communities, as well as the Canadian Red Cross. So it really has been an impressive effort of a bunch of people working together to make sure that this resource is available and really a key part of reducing the spread of this virus in the province. So information about the various protocols, like the cleaning protocols, are being shared at all levels. Those have been established. Daily wellness checks are happening for all those who are staying in these isolation centers, and they follow the public health protocols. And as a reminder, if a client or someone who's staying in these spaces, if their health does deteriorate, we would be taking them to a hospital for further assessment. Clients who are in these spaces receive 3 meals a day, and they're provided with various things to do and activities within their rooms, but also passes to get outside and get some fresh air a couple times a day if they're asymptomatic. For the hotel isolation center, I can report that 15 people have been referred there and since April 4th, and 3 have ended up accepting the offer to stay. Meanwhile, 13 people have stayed at the isolation center for those experiencing homelessness since opening last Thursday night. So currently 11 people are staying there as of Tuesday evening. We expect at the shelter that there'll be 39 rooms that will be open and in use by the end of this week. And to date, more than 30 hotels and inns from across the province have inquired about hosting isolation centers. So that's great, because we weren't sure if there'd be a lot of interest. So that's really positive. And we expect to open more locations in various areas throughout the province if and when the spread of this virus continues. And just lastly, I want to recognize the indispensable work of the emergency dispatchers. Today, or this week, is National Public Safety Telecommunications Week. So emergency dispatchers across the province handle more than 1.2 million calls per year, coordinating with police and firefighters and paramedics to ensure that people get the help they need when they need it. And these people perform a crucial task, often cutting through a lot of chaos to gather essential information from callers that first responders who are headed to a scene need in order to perform their job safely and do it well. So this is an invaluable service, especially during a pandemic when every in-person interaction should be scrutinized for safety. So to the dispatchers and the support staff that are working in those dispatch centers for the city of Winnipeg and Brandon, as well as those who work for the RCMP and the Medical Transportation Coordination Center, I want to thank you very much for all your efforts. And with that, we will open up to questions.
Thank you. A reminder to our reporters online, you will have one primary question and one follow-up question. And then we'll see where it goes. From Global, Marnie.
Good afternoon, Marnie Blunt from Global News. Dr. Roussin, again, fairly low numbers today, and you've made it clear for the past few days that people should not be misinterpreting these numbers and letting their guard down with social distancing. Having said that, how concerned are you that people are not getting the message and will see low numbers and think that we're in the clear? What's your message to them?
Well, I think it's important, and that's one of the reasons why we've extended the Public Health Act orders to ensure that people get the message that this is still a very vital time, a very critical time in our outbreak, and we're going to continue our message. So certainly we want to continue to see low numbers, but the only way that's going to happen is if Manitobans continue to strictly adhere to the social distancing strategies that we have in place. And so this is a real critical time for this outbreak. If we can continue to have this success, if Manitobans continue to do their part, that means we're in a position to start loosening some of these restrictions at an earlier point in time. So it's really critical now that we continue our efforts.
And my second question is, it's been about 2 weeks now since we've made changes to be able to fast-track former nurses and healthcare workers back into the system to help on the front lines. Can you talk a little bit about what that response has been like so far and are more needed to compensate for staff who have had to self-isolate due to COVID-19?
Yeah, I think my understanding from discussion with our operations team is that people are managing with the staffing that they have okay. It's really now more a matter of building up capacity in preparation for if there's a surge, and also just making sure that public health and staff health and health links have what they need as our high priority areas. So in discussion with the College of Registered Nurses of Manitoba, they have identified that they have issued 9 temporary registrations, as well as there's 24 more in progress.
From the Brandon Sun, Bud.
Good day. Dr. Wilson, can you tell me the woman who died in Prairie Mountain? Did she have any underlying medical conditions, and was she in ICU in Prairie Mountain House?
There were underlying medical conditions and was not an intensive care patient.
You said not in intensive care?
Correct, not in the ICU.
Are there follow-up, any other patients in Prairie Mountain Health hospitalized right now with COVID-19?
I am not. I'm not aware of any admissions at this point.
From CJOB, Diana.
Good afternoon, Diana from 680 CJOB. Ms. Siragusa, what can you tell us about the personal protective equipment conservation strategy document? I believe that's in the works.
Yeah, we're always looking at our personal protective equipment. So we are looking at what other jurisdictions have put into place in terms of the need for gowns, gloves, masks, and in what environment with high-risk populations. So that's still being worked through. Most of that is online, what the guidelines are. And then I think when we talk about conservation, and we've talked about this a lot at our daily conferences, is that we need to be aware that the supply chain is precarious. And so we're really looking at it in short bursts in terms of like 2 weeks at a time. So we have a long-term strategy, but also reevaluating frequently, making sure that distribution goes out instead of maybe big bulk deliveries, shorter amounts so that we can ebb and flow with the challenges that we're facing. So I think in terms of conservation, we should always be looking at conservation. Part of the conservation is also looking at reusable supplies that can be reprocessed, and every opportunity we can to make sure that our staff are safe, the public is protected, and the equipment is and the supplies is where they need to be.
Thank you. And as a follow-up, we're hearing from some healthcare providers that there's kind of nervousness in some clinics, especially in rural Manitoba, that nurses and doctors who should be seeing patients in clinics and health centers don't have the PPE, and there's kind of a reluctance to see patients. What can you tell us about that, and how would you solve that problem?
Yeah, I think what I would suggest is there is supplies being sent out every day, and we meet with logistics, and they let us know when there's challenges with shipments coming in, but they also reassure us that the supplies are being delivered. So if you are a site and you have concerns, then probably raise it. I believe there's also, if it's not up yet, it will be up soon as a portal. Where you can go online to make your request, so that if it will be coming soon. And there are, you know, when we talk about conservation, it may be, it's a mix of keeping people safe and working in a different way. So if there are opportunities to do virtual visits, I would recommend that might be an opportunity. If inpatient or in-person visits are required, then absolutely that should happen. And then you need to have the PPE and use it appropriately. And there are venues where we can make sure that you get that.
From the Winnipeg Sun, Scott.
Hi, Scott Billick here, Winnipeg Sun. Question for Dr. Roussin. Was the woman who died, latest death, was she hospitalized at all? Just looking at the hospitalization then, and they haven't changed since yesterday. So just wondering if at all, if you can update that.
Yes, this was this person was hospitalized.
Okay. And I'm just wondering, with the low case numbers that are coming in, do you have a sense of the impact that's having on the research being done at the University of Manitoba?
Right. So, so I haven't received an update about how many people have been enrolled. Certainly, that research there, the hydroxychloroquine study, is confirmed cases and their contacts or healthcare workers that have been exposed to confirmed cases. So. I don't know the uptake of that trial. Certainly, the more cases we had, the more people who would be eligible for that. But I don't know exactly how many people are enrolled at this time.
CBC Radio Canada, Julian.
This is a question for Dr. Roussin. Some provinces like Quebec are considering maybe reopening schools before the end of the year. Regarding the situation here in Manitoba, do you think this is a realistic schedule for us?
So we are we're behind those provinces in our trajectory. So they've had cases a lot longer than us. So at this point, we're dealing with this critical point in our outbreak. We're going to continue with whatever measures that is dictated by the evidence, but we're looking at all sort of exit strategies, what type of things might be in the near future. So right now that's not something that's been specifically addressed, but nothing's been off the table as we address this, and nothing will be off the table as we look at how we're going to start reopening things. But I don't have anything specific to comment on that.
And I have to follow up just a bit more in detail in the numbers. You're saying that there is 132 active cases, but when we subtract the number of people recovered and the number of diseased from the 246, we have 133. So I was just wondering if the number is right.
Yeah, well, those numbers are always being reconciled. So, you know, we have some of our probable cases are named as probable cases. if they were symptomatic and had very close contact with a case, we might just name them a probable case pending the test result. And then if we get a negative result, that's why sometimes there you're seeing, like, for instance, today, two probable cases. When we got their test back as negative, then they're removed from our case count. So it's probably just the numbers like this. The numbers are coming and changing frequently. So we'll continue to follow up on that.
From CBC Manitoba, Bart.
Bart McKee, the CBC. Dr. Leeson, your counterpart in the Ottawa Health Region, basically told people to stop hanging out at a safe distance but with their neighbors. What specific advice do you have, about people in Manitoba hanging out on their front steps, in their back patios, in their driveways, in parks, near their neighbors and friends?
Yeah, so I mean, I think that again, this messaging here is if it's an individual who needs a black and white answer, the answer is stay home, right? So if people can deal with a bit of using judgment, then we can say certainly out on your front steps and on your driveway, enjoying the outdoors in your backyard is okay. Shouldn't invite your neighbors over into your backyard. But enjoying the outside around your house, going for a walk around the block, if you're certain you can maintain that 2 meter separation, going to the park, if it's not crowded and you can keep that 2 meter separation, then okay. So, you know, so messaging is always difficult because you want to make sure that the clear message is, stay home as much as you can, go out for essential reasons. Weather's getting nice. It'd be nice to be able to enjoy it out, and certainly I would say enjoying out in your yard is fine, but not to have your neighbors over, even you know, even outside, is probably the best advice right now. We're at the critical stage, so let's keep our efforts in place right now, and we might be able to see a time relatively soon when we can start loosening some of these restrictions.
From CTV Winnipeg, Michelle.
Hi, it's Michelle Gillen from CTV. I'm wondering about Manitoba's mortality rate. Is it within what you guys are expecting?
Oh, sorry, I didn't catch that.
The mortality rate in Manitoba, is it within what you are expecting?
That's right. So, you know, look at Canada and then many other jurisdictions, we see about that 2% mortality rate. And so we're keeping in with the hospitalization rate and the ICU rate, and our mortality rate is keeping in line with that of Canada.
Also, we've asked you before about the modeling, but can you tell us where you're at with that and when we might do something?
Yeah, we're still working on that, and certainly because of where we are in our trajectory, because we've had relatively low numbers because we're early on, the modeling data is it proves more difficult. The more data you can enter into these models, the more likely they're going to be reflective of numbers that are reasonable to share and to guide some of our practice. So we're working on it. We're going to try to get some numbers to show Manitobans, but the combination of our relatively low numbers and where we are in our trajectory, it does make modeling a bit more difficult.
We're just going to go back to CBC Manitoba Bartley for his follow-up.
Yes, Dr. Ruth, and also your counterpart in the United States, the main counterpart, he's got a much more difficult job, I'm afraid, has made comments stating he doesn't believe professional sports will have fans this calendar year. What is your opinion? You said that social distancing measures will be lifted in stages. Do you believe there will be professional sports in Manitoba this calendar year with fans in the stands?
Yeah, it's really, it's difficult, you know. So, I mean, all I can say is that we're going to be dealing with this virus for the foreseeable future. We're going to be dealing with this virus certainly throughout this calendar year. What exactly that's going to look like is difficult. So to make a prediction about those things is not really reliable one. It's too early for me to say something like that. What I would say is that how we deal with this virus isn't going to look like what we deal with it right now. You know, we are going to be able to loosen up some of these measures. What exactly that will look like, it's going to have to depend on our epidemiology and the response to our gradual lifting.
From the Canadian Press, Kelly.
Dr. Roussin, you mentioned on Monday that there'd actually be a tightening of the restrictions sometime this week. With the numbers remaining relatively low, is that still the plan?
We still have plans in the works to look at further public health orders, and it's again it's a reflection of this critical time that we're in, that we know that we're facing, facing this period where we know that the virus is here. We know we've seen some of community transmission of this virus, but at the same time we've been reporting low numbers, so we don't want to set ourselves up. For a place where we, reverse all of the progress that we made here. So we're going to continue forth with our public health orders. That may include some additional measures coming this week, because this is that critical time. And so we want Manitobans to be well aware of it, that the efforts are working, we're quite grateful to Manitobans for all the efforts they put in to flattening our curve. But now we cannot loosen those measures right now, so we're going to continue to push forward.
And Dr. Roussin, some areas of Canada are talking about how they're starting efforts in regards to rolling out blood tests to detect COVID antibodies. Are there plans for this in Manitoba?
So overall, there are going to be plans for it. Our public health lab is certainly looking into that. We don't have it implemented as of yet. So just to be clear that these are not going to be useful in the diagnosis of cases. It's going to be useful in perhaps showing us immunity to the virus, as well as prevalence studies to give us a bit better understanding of how widespread this virus is. So yes, we're looking into it, and our public health lab will be involved, but that work hasn't started yet.
From City News, Alex.
Good afternoon. Dr. Roussin, what other further kind of travel restrictions can Manitobans see now that the government is passing a bill that gives you that power to do so?
Right, so I think that the international travelers right now are required to self-isolate under the Quarantine Act, and I think that's the biggest risk of importation right now, certainly to our neighbors to the south. So I think that's quite important. We know that with our numbers being reported as relatively low at this point, there's other jurisdictions in Canada that have higher numbers. And so some of the thought there is whether we've been advising and strongly recommending that people self-isolate from interprovincial travel. And so one thing we're looking at is whether we want to have that under, under the shape of an order.
All right, thank you.
From the Winnipeg Free Press, Danielle.
Good afternoon. Danielle De Silva from the Winnipeg Free Press. Dr. Benderson, I'm just following up on the previous question. With the legislation to provide you more power to restrict movement within Manitoba, I'm wondering if that is something that you'll be considering as well, whether that's restrictions on movement to rural communities from Winnipeg or to cottage country, things of that nature.
So these are all things that have been under consideration. And it's it's the same message, is that we're at that critical juncture right now where we need to ensure we're doing everything we can to limit the transmission of this virus. We're going to need to continue to focus on on situations that that would be high risk if the virus is introduced into, so things like long-term care facilities, congregate settings, and including remote isolated communities. So those are all things that have always been under consideration, and we're still looking at that for sure.
Thank you. And my follow-up question is for Lanette Siragusa. So following up on some of the home care pullbacks within the WRHA, I'm wondering if you're supportive of assisted living and retirement homes, perhaps allowing family members into those facilities to perform some of the services such as bathing and laundry, respite, things of that nature while the home care services have been temporarily suspended, and if it can be done safely.
Yeah, so the home care, if it's impacting patients at home and in that they can't their outcomes would be affected by it, then it's really not recommended. So there are guidelines to that each regional health authority would apply and look at on a case-by-case basis. So in terms of people who live in long-term care or seniors' homes, you know, the visitor restriction still applies at this point, so it would really have to be carefully looked at, because we don't want to be introducing this virus into a personal care home environment. So there would have to be very stringent screening and reasons that would be evaluated in terms of what is the staff requirements and what is the patient requirements, and how do we make sure that those needs are met.
Thank you.
All right, to our reporters online, we have a few more moments. Anyone have further questions?
Yes, Dr. Roussin, you mentioned in your opening statement that people were kind of presenting late to hospital because they might be a bit concerned about the safety of going to hospital. How severe are these things that they're kind of showing up with that are being caught too late? Like, is it a life and death problem? How big of an issue is it?
Yeah, well, certainly some of the things that have been reported to me by my colleagues have been quite quite important, quite critical. So that's why we mention it here. And some of the feedback we get are that some people are, you know, hesitant about attending because of the fears of COVID-19. Others, in fact, reported feeling guilty about utilizing healthcare services during this time. And so neither one of those should be a barrier to anyone attending healthcare. So healthcare is safe right now. We've ramped up our capacity. And so people who need medical care can access it. There's no need to be hesitant about it. Certainly the message is there. If you're mildly ill, then certainly stay home. Don't go to work if you're mildly ill. But if you need health care, our facilities are safe and they are ready to assist.
And if you want direction, you can also call Health Links and they can provide some guidance.
Dr. Newsom, Bud Robertson, again, is the grandson. Regarding the woman in Prairie Mountain Health, had she been hospitalized for any length of period before she succumbed, or had she just come into emergency?
Yeah, I don't have all the dates of the admissions or anything of the such, so I know it was a hospital-based death and occurred in Prairie Mountain Health.
Dr. Roussin, Bartlett-Kivas here. What connection should we make between your statement about late presentation of medical symptoms and the death of a person who wasn't in ICU at Prairie Mountain?
Oh, the no connection between that. These were conditions that were unrelated to COVID. And ones that would seemingly prompt people to attend for health care. And just some reports from my colleagues indicated that they felt that the delay may have been related to their being apprehensive about heading out to a hospital because of COVID being out there. And even in one report that they felt they didn't want to impose on an already overworked healthcare system.
Thank you.
So again, neither of those should deter anyone from attending health care should they require it.
And Dr. Roussin, are you able to elaborate about the antibody research testing that you mentioned in brief yesterday? Can you elaborate upon when that would be rolled out, for what purpose, and how?
Yeah, I can't elaborate too much because we don't have anything specific underway. But when we look at antibody testing in an epidemic situation, we'll do it for a couple of reasons. One is to determine immunity, determine whether the antibodies do provide protection, whether they're neutralizing antibodies, and that can help us moving forward in people who may or may not be susceptible to infection. The other is seroprevalence studies, where we do widespread testing just to get an idea of how much of the population may have been affected by the virus, how much asymptomatic people who develop infection, develop antibodies, who had very mild or undetected symptoms. So it can also help with some of our modeling and our response.
Thank you. Dr. Roussin, how about...
Scott Bill, Winnipeg Sun. I just wanted to ask Lanette a question, just to clarify. So you updated us with 21 healthcare workers. There were 7 nurses, 3 medical staff, 10 from other areas. That adds up to 20. Is there one missing there that you didn't say?
Well, let me just check there for you. No, 7 nurses, 4 medical staff, and 10 from various allied health and support areas.
Okay, so 4 medical staff. Okay, thank you.
Sorry.
Kelly Malone, the Canadian Press. Health experts are saying that massive testing is needed for us to truly understand containment, and who said that was one of the things that we needed to understand before lifting any restrictions. Alberta's expanding their testing to anyone with symptoms, but it looks like Tatum only did about 300 tests yesterday, and previously we were seeing numbers around 500 tests daily. Why is that number dropped, and do we have the capacity to test widely yet?
So this the drop in those numbers was largely a reflection on the demand. And so those are there is no backlog at CADM, so they're testing samples as they're received. And so we are going to be announcing tomorrow some expansions to our testing criteria. In order to, again, bring those sample numbers up to ensure that we are getting a good sample from the population to give us a good idea as we start moving forward with considerations to lifting some of the restrictions. And so certainly CADM has the capacity to do more than what's been brought to them right now.
We have time for a couple more questions, if reporters have any last questions.
Dr. Roussin, do you have a... Go ahead.
I'm sorry, it's Marnie from Global. We're just still hearing some complaints or concerns from viewers about limited prescriptions for picking up the pharmacy. There's still concerns over... making 3 times the trips to the pharmacy when they're supposed to be staying at home and paying 3 times the dispensing fee. I know we asked you about this a few weeks ago. Is this something that you would look at changing?
So, again, yeah, so, I mean, this was put in place for as the we're preparing for the pandemic to ensure that there we didn't have any shortages in critical medication supplies. And so this was done at a number of jurisdictions throughout the nation to ensure that medications would be continue to be available. So just like any of our interventions, we continually review it. We continually see whether it's still needed, if there's any changes that are required. So then this is no exception. We're going to continue to look at that and see if we are going to adjust that moving forward based on what we see here with our numbers.
Dr. Roussin, this is Barbara Kiva from CDC. Of the five people who have died from COVID-19 in Manitoba, can you break them down in terms of community transmission or travel or connected to a known case?
Yeah, I don't. I don't have that in front of me, Bartley, with the deaths there. Just some of the demographics that I shared in the past. So, I don't have those numbers to report.
The ethnic origin or national origin data that you said it was going to be posted. When are we going to see that?
We're still working on how to compile that. And how that's going to be shared. So that's something in the works.
And that concludes today's media briefing. Thank you.